This is Dimitri Lascaris for the Real News Network. The stated goal of the Paris Climate Agreement is to keep the global temperature rise this century well below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, and to pursue efforts to limit the temperature increase even further to 1.5 degrees Celsius. But more and more climate scientists have been saying that the 1.5 degrees Celsius goal is now unrealistic. A new study, however, published in Nature Geoscience, concludes that the 1.5 degrees Celsius warming limit is not yet a geophysical impossibility. That study is entitled Emission Budgets and Pathways Consistent with Limiting Warming to 1.5 degrees. As the Real News has documented in our feature-length documentary, Trump, the Koch Brothers, and Their War on Climate Science, the climate change denial machine is a well-oiled, multi-million-dollar operation designed to prop up the fossil fuel industry by sowing doubts about climate science. Not surprisingly, the denialists have seized on the Nature Geoscience study to sow doubts about climate change. But the two scientists who authored the study are fighting back, and one of them is joining us today to discuss the misuse of their study. Dr. Richard Millar is a climate physicist and an Oxford Martin Fellow at the University of Oxford. Dr. Millar and his co-author, Miles Allen, recently penned an op-ed in The Guardian in which they denounced the misuse of their study. The Guardian op-ed was entitled, "When Media Skeptics Misrepresent Our Climate Research, We Must Speak Out." Dr. Millar joins us today from Oxford in the United Kingdom. Thank you for joining us today, Dr. Millar.
Thanks, no problem.
So first, I'd like you to discuss your study. What did you conclude about the feasibility of keeping the global temperature increase to less than 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels?
Sure. So what our study did was to look at what we call the carbon budget for 1.5 degrees, which is essentially how much CO2 emissions the globe could emit between now and any time in the future and still have a good chance of keeping warming below the 1.5 degree threshold. These numbers that have been used in many analyses for what the remaining budget might be to have a good chance of keeping below 1.5 degrees have been very, very small. You know, it's maybe as small as a few years of remaining, a few years of emissions at present day emissions rates. What our study does is look again at this question of exactly how big is this carbon budget, or how big might it be to limit warming beneath 1.5 degrees. And what we find is that it might be a little bit bigger than some of these previous budgets, maybe as much as 20 years at current current emissions rates, which is this total same amount of carbon as if the globe reduced its emissions from where we are today to net zero across the whole globe in about 40 years or so. So while we find that 1.5 degrees is not yet impossible, geophysically impossible, it's still a really large challenge in order for the global economy to be completely decarbonized, to have net zero emissions into the atmosphere on these kind of timescales. And so it's a real challenge now to the policymakers, if they're serious about about achieving this goal that they set for themselves in Paris, then there are substantial actions that will need to be implemented by policymakers around the world for this 1.5 degrees to actually still to keep remaining a geophysical possibility into the future.
Now, you said your study examined what we need to do to have a good chance. Those were the words you used, to remain within that limit. How do you quantify a good chance? What does that mean exactly?
That's a good question. Yeah. So what we've used in the paper, which is a number that's often used in analyses of climate policy, is to have a 2/3 chance of staying below 1.5 degrees. Now, of course, that's a value judgment. You know, maybe individuals say, no, that's not a good enough threshold to be sure that we'd stay below 1.5 degrees. Maybe we want a higher threshold, which would be a lower carbon budget than what we report. Or maybe alternatively, people say, you know, maybe a 50-50 chance of 1.5 is sufficient for me. So our numbers are centered around this 2/3 below probability of staying below 1.5. But that's inherently a value choice.
So please tell us a little bit about the methodology of your study. What did you do that was different from past studies and that led to this somewhat different conclusion that you reached?
So what we've done is to look carefully at this ensemble of computer models of the climate system that we have for thinking about these questions. These are called Earth system models, and they simulate the responses of the fundamental physics of the atmosphere and the ocean and the carbon cycle to changes in CO2 concentrations, to try and understand things about present, past, and future climate. So what we find is that when we're thinking about warming thresholds that are really close to today's levels, you know, for instance, the 1.5 degree threshold, we're about, you know, around two-thirds of the way there, because we're about 1 degree or so of human created warming today. That when we think about thresholds that are so close to today, that we have to really think about how we can best use this modeling ensemble to tell us about what pathways might be compatible with this goal. So what we found is that if we correct for sort of a few small biases in terms of how these very complex computer models simulate warming for a given amount of CO2 to better capture exactly where we might be today, we find that taking account of these small biases does actually matter a little bit for thresholds so close to where we are today in terms of the amount of carbon that might be left. So that was one avenue that we used in the paper to examine this question. We also used a couple of different avenues. We used a simple climate model, which is just a sort of a couple of equations that represent the overriding physics of the climate and carbon cycle system. And with that, we were able to sample like quite important parameters in terms of how much warming might we expect for a certain amount of CO2. You know, what is the exact contribution of methane forcing to the climate change we see today and to the future, and to sample those uncertainties. And using that procedure, we come up with a roughly similar answer to using the complex climate models. So that's an additional avenue of evidence that we investigated in the paper.
Now, in your Guardian op-ed, you and your study co-author wrote, "Our climate paper underlined that strong action towards the 1.5 degrees Celsius Paris goal is perhaps more valid than ever. But reading some of the media coverage, you might think the opposite was true." Now, how is your study being misquoted and misused, and who are the principal culprits in the misuse of your study?
I guess what we see going on is that a lot of the issues that are discussed in this paper, it's actually quite a technical paper, I think, and talk about warming per ton of cumulative CO2 emissions. And now, the way these Earth system models actually work is that emissions are actually an output of the model. We run the models with telling it how much carbon dioxide was in the atmosphere in a given year, and the models calculate what warming that gives you and what cumulative emissions that might be compatible with that. And because those are two outputs, and because these are really complex models, we expect there to be a certain amount of discrepancies between the real world and these models. And as I said, for 1.5 degrees, these like small effects that are totally expected in constructing a computer model that's complex enough to capture the whole Earth system, these are expected, but we need to account for them. I think the way that this is kind of been taken in some spheres is to say that what our paper was saying was that these models are predicting the wrong amount of warming for a given amount of carbon dioxide in the air. Now, that's not what our paper was about, which is quite a subtle difference, but I think it's an important one for talking about predictions of global warming into the future. And our fundamental, the magnitude of how much CO2 emissions affect the climate system from today onwards within our modeling and within our study is perfectly consistent with the evidence that's been presented through the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and through many other studies in the literature in the past.
Now, I understand there has been some pushback from the scientific community and those who continue to be of the view that we can't realistically meet the 1.5 degrees Celsius goal given the amount of greenhouse gases that have already been emitted. What is the essence of their critique of your study, and how do you respond to that critique?
Well, I think there's a couple of things being discussed, and science is a continuing conversation. These things always start interesting discussions, and I'm sure there'll be further discussions in the literature coming out of these things, but they've kind of centered around a couple of different things. One is, what is the exact right level of human-induced warming in the climate system today? And it sounds like a simple question to say, what is the present day temperature? Do we know it? Well, can't we just measure it? And yes, we can, but we don't have a complete measurement record absolutely everywhere in the world. And so there are interesting questions about, for something like the Paris Agreement, should we use just observational temperatures and you know, add them up and get a global temperature from just where we actually have real measurements of the data? Or should we try and use clever statistical techniques to sort of infill in some of the gaps in where we can measure temperatures, and particularly there are gaps over the Arctic? Our paper makes a certain choice in that, so that in that we use data sets that were available at the time of the Paris Agreement. So data sets that directly informed the negotiators in terms of when they were deciding, you know, these are present day climate impacts for this this amount of warming. And, you know, so to make a decision about what impacts might be at 1.5 degrees, at 2 degrees, and whether that's a thing that they wanted to commit themselves to. So maybe a different definition will be used in the negotiations in the future, but at the moment that's not clear, and it really falls to the climate negotiators to, you know, define what are the metrics that they're going to use to measure their progress through this agreement. And the other main area that that discussion has taken place around is whether there is like locked in warming, essentially locked in warming that we don't see today, but we're committed to from past emissions. And now, actually, in fact, the amount of warming that we're committed to from past CO2 emissions, from past carbon dioxide emissions, is actually very small. In the completely hypothetical scenario, if we could stop emitting tomorrow, CO2-induced warming would not change much from what it is today. You know, temperatures would stay roughly flat for centuries following. So CO2-induced warming is very permanent, but it's very much future emissions that control future warming. Now, of course,
there is some additional warming locked in. What do you quantify that to be?
There's not really much. I mean, so our best estimates are that probably it is quite small. You know, it's potentially even negative, because CO2 induced warming, you know, if we were to bring our emissions to zero, we'd expect, based on the scientific literature that's out there, that we actually wouldn't see much more warming once we stopped emissions. Now, of course, there are other things affecting the climate system. There's methane, there's particles, aerosol particles that come from burning coal that actually have a cooling effect. And whether we stopped emitting, whether we get any more warming at all, would be in some level determined a little bit by the balance between how much aerosols are cooling us versus how much methane is warming us. And actually, the latest estimates indicate that that would be about equal. So we'd probably expect, you know, if they were both reduced towards zero at the same rate, then there to be, you know, again, little committed warming going into the future.
And is there disagreement, a significant disagreement in the scientific community about how much additional warming is locked in?
I wouldn't say so, no. I mean, it's very clearly summarized in the last assessment report of the IPCC that CO2-induced warming is very small. There's obviously uncertainties about aerosol relative forcing, and if the aerosol, the amount of sort of cooling potential of aerosols is actually quite large, then there could be some sort of unmasking of warming that we might see. But our best estimates of relative forcing at the moment indicate that that's probably balanced by the methane warming. So as both of those change into the future, exactly what happens is going to depend on the precise balance of methane warming and aerosol cooling. But a lot of scenarios actually show that those two effects cancelling out about today, but also continuing to cancel into the future. So our best estimates are probably that there's little committed warming if we stopped emissions today. Now, of course, that doesn't mean there's not locked in emissions from the energy sector. You know, we're not going to just stop emitting straight away tomorrow. In reality, there are power plants built, and, you know, people aren't going to want to turn off those power plants instantaneously tomorrow. And it probably wouldn't be desirable for us to just shut everything down instantaneously. So there's an economic lock-in of emissions, but and therefore a lock-in of warming if we do run those power plants to the end of their lifetime, say, but a physical lock-in is actually quite small.
And recently, a study called Importance of the Pre-Industrial Baseline for Likelihood of Exceeding Paris Goals. And that study examined the implications of different choices of the pre-industrial baseline on the likelihood of exceeding the two temperature thresholds in the Paris Accord. And the study seemed to suggest that our carbon budget is smaller than generally believed. Can the results of your study be reconciled with those of the study co-authored by Michael Mann?
Well, yes. I mean, absolutely. If there were different choices for what the pre-industrial baseline is, then that will affect remaining budgets, as was pointed out in that paper. But I think, as I mentioned earlier, I think it's also important to acknowledge the context that the Paris Agreement was made in. I mean, the governments and the negotiators had information about warming today, impacts today, and impacts at 1.5 degrees and 2 degrees. And these were set against a specific baseline, which pretty much was the baseline used in the IPCC fifth assessment report, which was an 1850 to 1900 baseline. So I think while this is an interesting academic discussion, I'm not 100% sure how directly relevant it is to the Paris Agreement process, because in some ways this decision has already been made by the agreement in terms of the information it was using in terms of impact assessments of 1.5 degrees and 2 degrees relative to this 1850 to 1900 baseline. And that's, I think, an important thing that we have to bear in mind, that this is, you know, not just a scientific project. This is also, you know, it's a political and international policy project. That baseline is actually very much more consistent with the one we use in our study.
And lastly, let's talk about the political commitments that have emerged from the Paris Accord and in light of your new study. The signatories to the Paris Accord, which included all the major emitters, agreed to make certain commitments regarding emission reductions. In light of your study, are the current emission reduction commitments of the major emitters adequate to achieve the goals of the Paris Accord? And how much warming can we anticipate if those commitments are fulfilled but not exceeded?
So that's an interesting question. And I think it comes down to, one, recognizing that the commitments in themselves don't actually get us any amount of warming, because what we do understand from the science is that warming only stops when CO2 emissions stops. Now, the pledges from the Paris Accord were to reduce emissions a bit from baseline. But in order to stop warming, whether that's at 1.5 degrees, 2 degrees, 3 degrees, or any other threshold, we still need to get emissions to zero. So at the moment, the pathways that we discuss in our paper coming out of where we are today and trying to meet these 1.5 degrees, even the pathways that have the smallest emissions reductions in the near term, and therefore, of course, the most steep ones in the medium to long term, because they all need to get to zero by the time these budgets are used, even those pathways would still require a strengthening of the Paris pledges by, you know, at least 10%. And for us to, you know, to actually have a plan to eliminate net emissions of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere from the global economy. So we actually discuss in the paper how, in order to sort of offset some of the risks that rates of reduction might prove to be, you know, socially, technologically, economically, and politically infeasible, that actually increased ambition in terms of how much we can reduce our emissions in the near term, so what's pledged for 2030 as part of the Paris process, would really help offset some of these risks of requiring, you know, infeasibly rapid reductions in emissions after 2030 if we still were to meet this 1.5 degree carbon budget. So our research is very clear that increasing near-term ambition would help address many of these feasibility dimensions of actually sticking to this still pretty tight carbon budget.
Well, this has been Dimitri Lascaris speaking to Dr. Richard Millar of Oxford University regarding a new study examining the feasibility of the 1.5 degrees Celsius target under the Paris Climate Accord. Thank you for joining us today, Dr. Millar.
Thank you very much.
And this is Dimitri Lascaris for The Real News.